I'd like to ask the corporate officer to confirm that all due process was followed according to the Local Government Act for this public hearing for 273 Burke's Drive vacation rental.
Yes, Your Worship, 273 Burke's Drive, zoning amendment by law 2169. We received two letters of opposition, which you have in your package.
Thank you. We have started the speakers list, there has been some indication of people that wish to speak. After I go through the speakers list, I'll be opening up the floor to the public for a minimum of three times for people to address council on any comments that they have on 273 Burke's Drive. And the first person on the speakers list, Mr. Sullivan, did you have a short presentation on this?
Great presentation.
Okay.
As noted, the subject property is located at 273 Burke's Drive. It is located within an established residential neighborhood. The purpose of the application is to rezone to the R1B Single Family Residential Vacation Rental Subzone in order to permit vacation rental use. The applicants are proposing to use the one-bedroom secondary suite as the vacation rental. There is vacation rental on the ground floor. I'll leave it at that.
Okay, thank you. So going to the speakers list, the first person that's indicated that they wish to speak is Beryl Buckley.
I'm 3 Burke's Drive, and my main concern listed in the letter is increase of traffic.
Louder, please.
My main concern is the increase of traffic because of the school zone being so close, and we do not have sidewalks, therefore there's no visual division for pedestrians and vehicles, and I'm concerned with the children.
Thank you. That's the only person that indicated they wish to speak on the speakers list, but the floor is open for anybody that wishes to address council.
Council?
Yep. Just please state your name and address for the record.
My name's Nancy Jensen, I live at 253 Burke's, which is two doors down from the proposed vacation rental. So, you know, I've come here with open mind and with my concerns, and my concerns are, it's been operating illegally for I'm not sure how long. And last winter, there was a large amount of vehicles out in front. One time, I think I counted 9 vehicles. So like the, and I know, I have lots of concerns, and like the neighbors, that own their 2 doors down, I've never met. So it would be, and you addressed that, which would have been nice if they had come and talked to me and say, we're thinking about doing this vacation rental, and this is what we're going to be doing, this is how we're going to manage it, this is what, but I never knew nothing. It just became a vacation rental, and I just kind of figured out it became a vacation rental because there's all these cars, and I started asking around. And I know that there are also absentee owners. I know upstairs is rented on a full-time basis, but as a, you know, long-term rental. I'm not sure if they're the ones that manage it, I'm not sure who manages it, so I'm really out of the loop. So my concern is like, and I appreciate that this is now becoming, that's something that you're going through a process with this, because they are coming up all over, and I have a lot of concerns, like across the street, I had a young family just move in, and Plumby Park is very much a family neighborhood, it's like there's no stores, there's no businesses, it's just a school and residential, completely residential area, and not meaning like most neighborhoods are residential neighborhood, but the young family that moved in across the street, they spent months trying to find a place. They were living in a little apartment with their kids. So do we have, you know, I think that, you know, my concerns is of these being like cash grabs, you know, they're, you know, one time it was just rented out, and so, but hey, you can make a lot more money with a vacation rental, so let's make more money with a vacation rental basis. But there's still, there's still a great need in our community for long-term rentals for families, for young couples, for people moving in that are wanting to stay and live here. And I understand there's a lot of illegals that we've got to crack down on, because we're, and there's other places too, like Vancouver's had a huge problem with their Airbnbs, that they're just, you know, people are just like turning their apartments and renting out into that, and so there's, you know, it's happening a lot of places, so it's just not here. So those are my concerns, is the how is it being managed, like when they're off-site, like, and then when you're off-site, if someone, you know, says, okay, you know, there's four of us coming to rent the apartment, or the, yeah, there's an apartment, coming to rent the apartment for a week, but 12 come. How do they know 12 come? We want to figure out there might be 12 there with all the vehicles that are out there.
Just to clarify, Nancy, this is what they're looking for here is a one-bedroom suite, which would be one vehicle, two people. Mm-hmm. So maybe they were doing full house before, but what the application is for one person. So I want to just clarify that.
Yeah, but you can advertise for like a one-bedroom suite, and like you're not there to turn off the keys and greet the people. I'm not sure how it happens, how you know how many people come, is my concern. How do you know? So there's many times as not.
I've never actually slept in a room with nine other people, but
yeah, but there's a lot of vehicles there sometimes, so I'm not sure how many people are staying there.
Yeah.
Maybe it's the renters upstairs, I don't know, but it's concerns, yeah. and then taken away from the long-term rentals that we have, that we need. And I know they were talking the other properties, the concerns of, they were saying, oh, before, well, the one thing that dressed, the property manager saying, oh, it's hard to get long-term rentals, I beg to differ. Because I know my daughter downtown has a four-suited house, and she's had long-term rentals for a long time, and there's no problem getting long-term rentals. If you're going to that market, you put the price to that market. So obviously, when you're getting into vacation rentals, you're putting a price to make a lot of money in a short amount of time. So. Okay. There's something else I can't remember. It might come back later. Thanks.
You're welcome to come back up if you like. Floor is open, and anybody would like to speak to this 273 Perk Drive.
My name's Wanda Watson, and I live at 268 Perk Drive. The vacation rental is directly across the street from our home. The person that owns the house has tried really, really hard. He's really friendly with all the neighbors. He listens to you if you have any complaints and addresses them. The upstairs is long-term rental. They have two vehicles. It's a young couple with a baby. They are giving me more problems than the vacation rental. They have two vehicles, and apparently it's too much trouble to move vehicles around and change them around. So one is parked in front of our house all the time because it's easier. You don't have to switch them around. The way he set it up, he has a double driveway, and one side of the driveway is for the upstairs tenants, and the other side of the driveway is for the downstairs. And they hold, each side holds two vehicles, so that's four vehicles that can be parked there on the property. We do occasionally, I don't know whether the people that are renting downstairs, vacation rental, probably have told their friends that, hey, we're going to be here, blah, blah, blah. We had nine vehicles out on the road at one time, which is a bit much, you know. And in the winter, if they do rent it to someone who is snowmobiling, then you get the big trucks with the big trailer on behind with the sleds, and it makes it difficult for parking as well. I think as long as the parking issue is addressed, I don't think there's a problem. We haven't had a lot of partiers or anything like that. We haven't had a lot of noise. They've been doing a pretty good job, I think. Like I say, as long as the parking is addressed and stressed to the owner. I don't know, maybe there can be a contact person, whoever's managing the property, that we can call and say, hey, look, we have to come and talk to these people about the parking.
Which is part of the application process, that somebody has to be available with a phone number to
And he doesn't rent it, vacation rental all the time. He and his family come and stay there. And he does renovations, and they come for Christmas or whatever. I also am questioning, I think there's a regulation as to how many nights per year that you can rent it out. Now, how do you control that? How do you keep track of that? How many nights that they have rented it out?
Well, there is a couple of ways that it can be done, and that's part of the next process that we're going to be going through after we get a report back from staff on vacation rental.
Yeah.
But it's 120 days is what it is.
Yeah, out of 365. So, yeah, that would make a big difference too, because if it's rented continuously, you know, that can cause problems too. Anyway, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Floor is open. Yes.
I just had a question. I'm not sure if I missed it. Kathy East, 1089 McCarty Crescent. So they're applying to have just the basement apartment zone.
That's right. The one bedroom suite.
And that's something you're still working on.
Yes.
How that would work. Right? And is that something that would stay on the title?
Yes.
It would stay on the title, so the home could change hands and they could rent the suite out.
Just like if it was a full house vacation rental.
I think what I'm hearing some of these people say is what we've been saying is that the problems arise when the homeowner is not on site, and so I just wanted to add that.
Okay, thank you. Floor is open for a second time for anybody that wishes to speak to 273 Perks Drive.
Yes. I'm in favor of the application. Thank you.
Thank you.
I just said I'm in favor.
Oh, okay.
Is there,
oh, you know, you should give me a reason.
For a second time, does anybody wish to speak to Vacation Rental 273 Perks Drive? For a third and final time, does anybody wish to speak on this Vacation Rental 273 Perks Drive? Looking for a motion to close this public hearing. Councillor Nixon, Councillor Sowles, all those in favor, motion's carried.
Your Worship, I'll bring forward for discussion purposes that Zoning Amendment Bylaw 2169 be read a third time.
Motion by Councillor Nixon, seconded by Councillor Sowles. Councillor Nixon.
Your Worship, I'm struggling with this one a little bit. Like, we're getting to where we're comfortable, where somebody lives on site, and they're wanting to have a vacation rental in their secondary suite. But I understand this proponent does not live in the house. And I see both sides of this, like hearing from the neighbors that he's trying to manage his rental as best he can. And a vacation rental, if there's adequate parking, would only be rented out for 120 nights a year, as long as we can find out how to use that. And so that might be a good thing for the neighborhood. And I'm hearing from the neighborhood that there's 9 cars out there. So I'm struggling with this one.
So the process that we've done in the past is with the single units was defeat them and then put them on the list for the next rezoning.
Yeah, add them to the room within the bed cap that comes to approve and bring it forward when the different classifications are created where it can be restricted to just a suite.
The wrinkle in this one for me is the owner doesn't live on site. It's
yeah, but council won't be able to require that it be an owner live on site.
No,
that would only be able to control that it be a long-term residential.
It could be a manager living on site, or it could be
a tenant.
It could be a tenant that likes to have peace and quiet like the rest of the neighborhood has too.
Mm-hmm.
So regardless, having somebody on site I think is proven to be a benefit to everybody. But there's a motion on the floor to approve the third reading. Is there any more discussion on the motion?
Yeah.
All those in favor? Against? Motion is defeated.
Your worship, I'll bring forward the motion to put it into the queue for bringing back consideration of those with a secondary suite.
Okay. Motion by Councilor Nixon, seconded by Councilor Salz. Discussion on the motion. Councilor Salz.
Your worship, I agree with Councilor Nixon. I think we need to put this in the queue for the single suite and add it back to the cap. I think then we can have another look at that and see if it's beneficial rather than shooting it.
Any more discussion on the motion? All those in favor? Motion's carried. So just to clarify to people that were here for this one, is that this vacation rental, because we don't have a subzone for single unit vacation rental, will be put over this special zone where they're only allowed one suite is where this is going to be going in. And then council will look at that and decide if it's going to give final approval or not. But it is not a full house vacation rental, and it's set aside for a single unit. Okay. We're moving into our next vacation rental public hearing. This is for 1065 McCarty Crescent. We can take a 2-minute break for those people that would like to leave. And of course, you are always welcome to stay and join us. Well, this is one of the things that we're going to be looking at. We're just going to have a limited That's just an arbitrary number we came up with. We're then council's going to look at the study, look at all these comments that people are making, the areas, and whatever comments are coming in. They're all going to be compiled. We're going to sit down and study. We're all going to have a follow-up. It's not going to work.
No.
That's coming up, and then we'll get the council decided, are we going to keep going forward, and we'll be... Yes, sir. And that's, I can't answer that question. Okay. There's going to be lots more, so you can hear more about it, and we'll probably have open meetings where2167, which is 1065 McCarty Crescent. I'll probably read the whole thing over since we have a change of people.
Sure, I won't.
This public hearing is being convened pursuant to Section 464 of the Local Government Act. At this public hearing, the public will be allowed to make representations to council, and all persons present who believe their interests are affected by the proposed bylaw shall be given the opportunity to address council or to present written submissions respecting matters contained in the proposed bylaw. Those of you who wish to speak concerning this proposed bylaw should commence your address to council by clearly stating your name and address. Then you may give us the benefit of your views concerning the proposed bylaw. Please observe the rules. If you have any concerns with the manner in which the hearing is conducted, direct your comments to the chair. Members of council may, if they wish, ask questions of you following your presentation. However, the main function of council members today is to listen to views of the public. It is not the function of council at this public hearing to debate the merits of the proposed bylaw with individual citizens. Everyone should be given a reasonable opportunity to be heard at this meeting. No one will be or should feel discouraged or prevented from making his or her views heard. In considering the proposed bylaw, council has received documents which may influence its decision. These documents are available for review in a binder located with the Director of Corporate Administration. Before we begin, I'd like to ask the corporate officer to confirm that all due process was followed according to the Local Government Act.
Yes, Your Worship, for 1065 McCarty Crescent Zoning Bylaw Amendment 2167, we received 7 letters of opposition, 2 letters of support, and there was 1 letter from the applicants that went out to the neighboring properties. And you have them all on your agenda.
So I have a speakers list set up. Some people have indicated that they wish to speak. After I go through the speakers list, we'll be calling to the public for a minimum of 3 times if they wish to address council. And before we get started, I'd like to ask Mr. Selvig if he has a presentation for us.
Thank you, Your Worship. As one of the properties located at 273 Perks Drive. No, I'm sorry, 1065 McCarty Crescent. And is currently, sorry, I lost my place. Currently, there's currently one other property on McCarty Crescent, which is in the rezoning process. The property is located within a newer residential neighborhood with a mix of newer homes and vacant lots. The applicants are proposing to use the entire 4-bedroom home as their vacation rental. It's not a very good, it's hard to see it, but you can see it. So I'll leave it at that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The first person that's indicated that they wish to speak is Lorna Higdon-Noring.
Thank you. I'd like you to consider today that I'm also, for practical purposes, representing my son's daughter-in-law. And my son is out of town, and my daughter-in-law is looking after our grandkids, so they can't be here, but they've got a letter from them as well, because they are, as Nikki said in her letter, where I noticed she didn't put her address, they are the nearest neighbors to this house, and they're very distressed about the situation. So that's last time we were here to discuss the possible suite rental, there were considerations, there were compromises, we were open to discussion. I have to say, I believe this is a very different atmosphere, a very different situation for the neighborhood. And it has been an unhappy situation. And it shows no sign of getting better anytime soon. Quite apart, there, from a policy perspective, and I spent a long time, I cannot come up with a positive argument in favor of this application. It is in a single family residential neighborhood with, depending on how you count, not between 9 and 12 children in close proximity. First and foremost, as with the last one, my biggest concern is always child safety. That corner is the street hockey corner, it's the lemonade stand corner, it's the one where you're on the skateboard. That's the playground for McCarty Crescent, right on that corner.
And it's not just traffic safety. It would not be an owner-present situation. It would be an owner-absent situation. And, you know, I'm sorry, I'm not a paranoid person, but I do worry about stranger safety. But, you know, we know we're all our neighbors. And when you just book somebody out of Airbnb, you don't talk to them, you just give them the run of the house. You don't know who's in your house. You don't have, you have no way, we have no way. So, no, that doesn't really ring my chimes. And, you know, you also really have very little control over what kind of activities they're going to be engaging in while they're in your house. And I noticed on the your website is the pamphlet that's been produced by the applicants. If we see any indication of illegal drug use inside or outside the house, the full security deposit will be forfeited. Good! I have a better idea. Let's not even run that risk. Okay? When my kids are on the street outside. That's just a much better plan. My second concern, obviously, is from the point of view of the adults in the neighborhood, the homeowners. It is just simply the loss of quiet enjoyment, as I think the bureaucrats always put it, of our property. We have built a beautiful neighborhood here. We protect our neighborhood, we take great care of it. We have lovely houses, by and large, at least I think we do. And we really enjoy living there, except when there are snowmobiles gunning at 6 in the morning and snow bikes racing. Whoever invented that thing should be called to account by St. Peter at the time. And those things have happened, and loud, raucous parties, and beer cans and alcohol bottles on the lawn, and so on. That is not the neighborhood we built. It's the neighborhood that the current owners bought into, for whatever reason, and now apparently need to generate supplementary income somehow to pay a mortgage. When my husband and I bought our first house, you know, we bought a house that we could flip. That would be my suggestion, is buy one you can afford. That you don't have to run either a vacation rental or a moving house, because that's the threat that they put in the letter to the neighbors, is, well, if you don't like a vacation rental, you're still going to have 3 or 4 tenants that we're going to be bringing in, parking their cars in the driveway. And I would suggest that they look up the definition of single family use, because I don't think that's what the city has in mind as rooming houses in our neighborhood either. So, I say, it is, I don't think it's our role to have to suffer to pay their mortgage. I don't think there is a single good argument for accepting this application. The operation of the unlicensed illegal vacation rental to date has certainly been less than stellar. And so I can only assume that that's as good as it got while it was pending approval, and it can only get worse. So I would respectfully, strongly on... And one last thing is that I noticed there is a letter in the file that suggesting that they went around and talked to all the neighbors. They did. We were, must have been away because we didn't have a discussion. But in this, they say many neighbors admitted they had some reservations, but after speaking to us, they felt much more comfortable supporting our application. I don't personally know any of those neighbors, and I have not seen any evidence that there are neighbors who support the application, except for the two in the neighborhood who currently have either a B&B or a vacation rental. Those are the two letters in support that I can see on their website. So I will, from the absence of evidence that there are actually neighbors comfortable supporting their application, I will respectfully ask you to take that with grain of salt.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The next person on the list that didn't indicate they wish to speak or not is Ben Harding.
No, thank you.
The next person in is Jackie Ryan.
Your Worship, and Council, my name is Jackie Ryan, and I am the owner at N65 Prairie Crescent, and also the resident with my Parker Glenn. We live there, we own this. I'm a little nervous, one second. Okay, so we bought our house in June with the intention of living there as our primary residence, which we are doing. But Ben works on a one-week on, one-week off schedule. So we decided that it would be a really good plan to try and get this zoning in place so that we could do infrequent vacation rentals of the whole house, but only up to like a maximum of 30 days per year. Because really, I'm going to be the one that's going to be cleaning the linen and all of the bedrooms and doing all of the work and doing the bookings and managing all that. When we bought the house, we outfitted it so that we could have certain closets lock up so that our personal belongings could be stored in there. During a few nights that we were going to plan that we rented renters, I would be staying at a friend's place. I would never leave town, always be in Revelstoke, always be actively involved with the booking, making sure that nothing is being disrupted. We're also just wanted to note that we're not restricting the renters to just the winter. We also want to have weekend rentals for the house all throughout the year and encouraging families that are coming to see like the Pike Poster or for mountain biking trips to be able to welcome them into our home and provide, you know, weekend rentals for families all year round. So how we're going to make sure that we don't cause disruption to the neighborhood, obviously that's a big concern. So we have four main ways that we're going to avoid that. The first is, first and foremost, we want to begin by making sure that we're marketing to the right audience, that we're making sure that right from the beginning we're being preventative and in our ad, which is the first avenue by doing this, is to make it clear who the house is intended for and who is not welcome. Our first line in our posting is nestled in a quiet corner of a wonderful residential neighborhood, our home is perfect for mature couples and adventurous families. This house has a maximum sleeping capacity of 8 guests and is not suitable for hosting any parties or events such as stags or stag guests. Please be mindful that all guests, unless accompanied by an adult, must be over the age of 25. So that's in the ad. The second would be tying it to the house rules and making sure that they know that they could be liable for noise and parking and any kind of infraction. And then again, building it in as part of their security deposit. So they can be liable potentially twice for doing any kind of like loud disruptive behavior. And making sure they know that before they book, as they're booking, and then, you know, Airbnb basically makes you agree to these house rules that we write ourselves. So that if they say, well, you know, they're going to follow this list of rules and they don't do it and we've assigned a fee, actually Airbnb can enforce it on our behalf with all their credit card information. Anyways, so there are ways in place also that we can make sure they know that we need business and that they can be held liable. And we also made a conscious decision not to put a hot tub in the house. Obviously, it's a really desirable amenity for a vacation rental home in this town, but we thought, you know, what if that attracts the wrong kinds of renters. We don't want that in our neighborhood. We don't want to invite the partying group. We want to make sure that we are inviting families and people that might not care so much about a hot tub. And also because a hot tub is outdoors and maybe that can create noise, and so just best to avoid it overall. The second way we're going to avoid the bad renters, we'll call them, is to screen the renters very heavily. We're not going to allow for automatic booking. So, you know, John Smith and wherever can't just say automatically, I'll book at our house. He has to request it. And then we have the chance to discuss with him, well, what is it that you're coming here for? What's the nature of your visit kind of thing? And we can make that judgment call. We also aren't going to let anybody book who doesn't have reviews, who hasn't rented from a host, or like a homeowner before and had positive experiences. So making sure that obviously there's enough demand in Revelstoke that we get this, you know, pool of requests and we can pick the absolute best applicant from that pool. And then thirdly, daily check-ins while the renters are there. So this is to ensure that, like I said, no more than 8 guests are coming or are there, that cars are properly parked and to make sure there's no damage to the house or to the property and disruption to the community. And like I said, I will be doing those check-ins. I thought it was a good suggestion even to do them at 11. It's kind of a late time, so in some instances, if there was nobody at home, I probably wouldn't ring the doorbell if they were all asleep, but a good time to go and do it to make sure that all of those rules are being abided by. We had three trial vacation rentals at the house that were booked through Airbnb this summer. I just want to make sure that stress that that was not illegal, those three. We tried with our careful marketing to making sure we're advertising to the right kinds of people. We had really diligent screening, and we were able to attract the perfect kind of renters. The first group was in town from Calgary for a wedding. Renters were family, and family friends of theirs were made, that's what made up the group. They were all mature adults, and they weren't really there much because they were at the resort for the wedding. The second group was also from Calgary, and it was four couples in their 30s visiting for a mountain biking trip. And the last group was an extended family from India across Canada road trip. And the last group in particular was a perfect example of the kinds of groups we want to attract and the type of vacation rental that we want to provide. I was at the house as they were checking out and received many thanks for letting us rent their place. They even left me a bunch of homemade Indian dishes that they had cooked at their house, or at our house, and they had spent time making. And when I was cleaning the house, I could really tell that they had spent a lot of time in the kitchen and in the living room, and I thought, like, this is pretty cool, you know, like, they might not have had this experience had they rented a hotel. So I'll have to say that we have had very excellent experiences in the three trials that we did, and there were no complaints from neighbors for those three, and we do believe that following a regimented screening process and letting people know in advance that parties are not welcome, that you can get the right type of renters. We're even going above and beyond because we know that there is some pushback. So we did create a brochure that does follow the same outline as the one that's sanctioned by Palm Springs for all vacation rentals in residential neighborhoods. It does, maybe I shouldn't have alluded to the illegal drug use, but I just wanted to make it very evident for these renters that those are the kinds of things that are not tolerated. It outlines best practices for being a good neighbor, so that probably didn't even need to be in there because mostly it covers topics such as noise, driving, parking, garbage. For example, an excerpt from the brochure reads, "Please be aware that there are many young children in the neighborhood and they're often out playing on the streets. Please drive extra slow when you're entering and exiting the neighborhood and make sure that you are being extra vigilant for children and pets on the road." Beyond that, we're also going to be, I'm going to be available 24/7 and able to be on site within 15 minutes. I'm never going to be out of town when we have renters, and we're never going to outsource our work to a property management company. It's always going to be me or myself or Ben, the people that are most heavily vested in this property that are reporting to make sure and check in on these renters. I'm sure a lot of neighbors might think, you know, all these promises and sound really nice, but what if we don't carry through with them, right? Well, this is where we're asking the community, the neighborhood, to give us a chance to trust us, right? And, you know, if we don't hold up our end of the bargain and we do end up causing disruption, there are measures in place that we could have our business license revoked and not reissued. It's not as if the neighbors no longer have a say. We just wanted to, you know, reiterate that. We're even prepared, if there is some kind of way, from the last hearing, it didn't seem like there is a way, but to add some kind of legally binding provisions to either our business license or to the zoning that either limit the number of stays to 30 nights, because that's all we're asking for, or to let it be tied to us as the owners. I mean, we've talked about this again, the issue of the type or the transferability of it all. But a lot of people who know me and Ben trust us. You know, they say, like, yeah, you're good, reasonable people. We believe that you're going to do the right thing, but what if you sell your house? So if there's a way for us to tackle that issue or, you know, table our application until the city has developed some kind of way of addressing that, we would be very interested in doing that and not throwing away our application fee. Now I'm going to address some of the concerns of the neighbors. So a couple of people have said that there's a high density of vacation rentals. From my understanding, when I look at a zoning map for the city, we don't have that in our neighborhood. We have one properly rezoned vacation rental at the end of our street on Cachado, and to my knowledge, it's no longer being used as a vacation rental. So I'm not sure if maybe the others are illegal or perhaps bed and breakfasts, but that's just not the case. Traffic. I know that's a big concern for some people. The reality, and no, it was not meant to be a threat, is that, you know, if we don't do this, we will have housemates. That's in our rights. You know, that's totally allowed. And if we have housemates, and considering maybe they like enter and leave the neighborhood by car once a day, sorry, twice a day, that's about 3,300 trips, cars in and out of the neighborhood, right? That's assuming we don't go ahead with the vacation rental. But if we do go ahead with the vacation rental, and it's just Ben and I, no housemates, in the house as we intended it to be when we bought it, thinking this is great, and then for those 30 days, perhaps we have 3-4 cars when we have vacation renters, that's only 1,275 cars. So it's about, or 1,276 cars. So it's about like 2/3 less if we go this route. So the whole issue of traffic is going to be improved if we're able to go ahead with this. How do we know it's only going to be 30 days? Of course, that's a lot of people would be wondering that. Well, like we said, if there was a way to tie to the business license, we're very open to that. Also, if there are neighbors that are interested in being notified when we have renters, we'd be very open to that. So we could say, you know, hey, if there was an email list, we have a set of renters coming this weekend, just wanted to let you know, here's my phone number, and I'm going to be available. Let me know if there's any problems, and if they wanted to, they could keep track of that. But it probably wouldn't even be for, 30 days. What if it becomes a party house? So I think, as I said before, you know, we're going to be very strict in speaking renters and making sure we only track the mature couples and families, and if there is issues, the business license can be revoked. But we've had really good success in the past. I don't think there's any reason to assume we won't do that going forward. We should have done our homework before buying here. To me, that sort of implies that we are seen as perhaps not capable of making good, smart, mature decisions, and that some people think this would translate in how we run our vacation rental. Hopefully listening to me justify our reasons for wanting to rezone our property is enough to convince you that I am in fact mature, I have done my homework, and you know, I've put a great amount of time into this application and attended council meetings, followed vacation rental zonings, read minutes, read articles online. You know, I'm following the story. I get it. We knew what we were doing. But we were also told, you know, well, your neighbors would have to have some good reasons to suggest that you were like negligent homeowners. Like, you know, they can't just not want it. Nobody wants it. Nobody wants this in their record. But they have to, you know, assume, like, they have to have reasons to show, like the first hearing today, you know, reasons proving that we were doing bad things and we were not being good neighbors, but that's not the case. We've also talked to neighbors, we have gone around, unfortunately not everybody was there when we went around, but we did make that effort. Another one that comes up a lot is the safety of young kids. As mentioned before, reduction in traffic, right? So we're proposing to reduce the amount of traffic. The main argument is like a lot of people see us and we don't have our own kids, so they assume that we don't really care about the safety of children, but that's not true. Of course we do, and we bought in this neighborhood for all of the same reasons that they did. We love that it's a quiet, safe neighborhood. We love all of the same reasons that they love the neighborhood. And we hope to one day have kids that also get to enjoy the freedom of being able to run around on the streets and not worry about, you know, dangerous drivers, and they can just play on the road. We want that. The owner is not on site while the renters are there. A big one, right? As we discussed before, the main issue is preventing the wrong people from making those bookings, because the right kinds of people often don't create issues. There are several examples of like very well-run, quiet vacation rentals that are seamless, no issues, right? It seems like legal suites with the owner on site seem to cause a lot less concern from the neighbors. But the reality is that the demand for full house rentals is not going to disappear, right? Like, if you're going to go on vacation with your family and you're seeking a space to rent, you know, many families do that so they don't have to be confined to a small hotel room. And understandably, many parents also don't want to share a space with a stranger. So I get that there is, like, this demand for a whole house, almost like a house exchange type rental type thing, is it exists, and I'm hoping that the city recognizes that there is this demand, and instead of defeating the rezoning applications for full house rentals, instead is able to recognize the homeowners that are going the extra mile, like ourselves, to ensure that it's done tastefully, responsibly, and doesn't disrupt the neighborhood. The last concern, the location is not a good fit. I would say the opposite. There is a demand for this kind of niche market, right? Families that don't want to be in the McKenzie Village type complex surrounded by out-of-towners and who enjoy being immersed in a Revelstoke community. I think, like I said, it's better us than someone who isn't prepared to take all those precautions, that are going to take the screenings, the brochures, the check-ins. We're doing all of the things. We're doing this best. We're trying every angle here. I've seen applications get turned down where the homeowner is not prepared to do these things, and that makes sense to me, you know? But I think that it would be a shame to close off our community to renters that can bring in more diversity and depth. Our neighborhood is so wonderful. That's why it's a perfect place to showcase our city. Also, our lots are quite a bit larger, so there isn't as much in the very close proximity. And as for actual physical location of the house, yeah, we're directly beside the park and an empty lot on the other side of us. So the only two houses that really need to drive down our road, there are only two houses that really need to drive down our road. And it's really quiet and out of the way for most people in the neighborhood. So unlike some of those high density areas, there's really nobody that we're affecting. Well, there is, of course, there's people we're affecting, but there's not that many, comparatively. The last thing I wanted to touch on is, I wanted to address one email in particular that the city received from a neighbor about our application. The email contains many defamatory remarks, and they're simply untrue, and I don't want that to affect council's decision, so I would really appreciate just a couple more minutes of your time to go through that to make sure nobody has these bad perceptions of us, because I don't think it's a very accurate reflection of who we are as neighbors or, frankly, as people. The email starts off saying that this neighbor is very familiar with the residents at 1065 McCarty Crescent. Not once since moving into the neighborhood in June has he introduced himself to either Ben or myself. Ben and I went by to introduce ourselves once and he was not home, so we left a friendly letter explaining our situation, inviting him to come over and talk to us if he had concerns so that we could discuss the matter further. We never heard from him, though we have been told that he has vocalized strong opposition to us, to other neighbors. When he walks by, he refuses to even look or acknowledge us. And frankly, this is not somebody who is familiar with the residents at 1065 McCarty. Not at all, not whatsoever. The email then discusses that since we've taken possession of the house in June, that it has been run as a hostel, and that he has noticed license plates from various places, God forbid. The house is not run as a hostel. We live there full time and have three seasonal renters because we were going about this application the legal way. So we said until we get that, we're gonna bring on some renters for the winter. They're great people. One guy is from Wyoming, so he's got Wyoming plates and he lives there full year round. He works with Selkirk Tangiers, working towards his ACMG guide, a wonderful community member. Another works full time for Parks Canada, but she got a car from Ontario, so she's got Ontario plates, hasn't switched them over yet. And we have BC plates, and when Ben and I are both from Ontario, so when we have family that comes out and visits from Ontario, they usually fly to Calgary, rent a car from Calgary, boom, there, suddenly we've got Alberta plates. So yeah, we have some, there are some different plates that you see in front of the house. anyways, it just, we're not a bunch of transients, we're very responsible, we all have working jobs. There's a reason that there are no cars during the day, because we're all at work, we're not seeing, we're just doing our jobs. Okay, because we are a group of single adults and we do all have our own cars, the minute one or two of us invite someone over for dinner, all of a sudden you go from having four cars to having six, maybe seven, right? So, shucks. But oftentimes those cars are there for a few hours. They're not parked there overnight. Yeah, and if they are staying overnight, if they are visitors who are staying overnight, we always try to make sure we shuffle the cars around and make sure no one's parked on the road, especially in the winter, because we don't interfere with snow removal. The only times, to my knowledge, the cars have been parked on the street overnight have been January 2nd. Ben's brother came over for dinner, went to go in his car, car battery was dead. He said, don't worry about it. Came back the next day, new car battery, car was gone. The other time would have been accidentally two nights ago, worst timing ever. One of our housemates had some visitors from out of town. My parents were also visiting this weekend, and he didn't want to box them in because my housemate told my parents had to leave early in the morning to catch a flight. So they parked on the street, poor timing. And the last time would have been New Year's Eve. We had some people on New Year's Eve, and you know, it wasn't a raging party, but I'm assuming that's the time that he's alluding to in his email, where he said that there were many cars parked on both sides of the street. And a few of them, most of them probably left before, like didn't stay there overnight, but a few of them were there the next morning, and frankly, I think that was the better decision. There was no snow that night, it didn't interfere. That was the same decision. I don't think I need to elaborate. Okay, so one of the other statements made in the email was about an incident that I recall unfolding much differently. At the time, I had no idea who the neighbor was that came and knocked on our door to aggressively accuse my friends for doing something they did not do. But after reading the email, it all seems a bit more clear to me. So in his email, it writes, I witnessed people exiting vehicles a block away to walk up to subject property for some gathering. I was walking my dog and moving in the same direction. The next morning, I noticed empty liquor containers strewn on a neighbor's lawn and at the side of the road. I knocked on the door of the subject house to let them know what one or more of their guests had done, thinking they might want to remind future guests to please be respectful of the community. The response I received was a terse denial that any such thing had happened, that no one parked over there was in our house. When I suggested I had seen cars parked and people walk over, I was given much stronger denial any such thing had occurred. I just turned around and walked away. Here's how I recall the situation. It was the weekend of August 28th. I know because we had, at that time, it was just Ben and I living in the house, and we had some friends from Calgary that wanted to come run the trail run at the resort, Trail Stoke. It's a 25-kilometer run up the last spike. I don't know why anyone would want to do that, but there are two couples, all doctors, all four of them actually, might say, one of them is in med school, the other three are all doctors, and one of the couples had like a one-year-old infant, and they were visiting, and then the next morning after their trail run, Ben and I wanted to try the pipe coaster. We had never done it, and so did the one of the doctors joined us, so we left the house, we came back, and the neighbors were kind of like stunned, or sorry, not the neighbors, our friends who were visiting were kind of stunned, and were like, hey, this man came up for, like, knocked on your door and asked if, like, where the homeowners were, and started accusing us of having a party and last night and for littering. They tried to they said that they tried to calmly notify this man that, like, he must be mistaken because they were all in bed, like, all of us were in bed by 9:30, like, they had just run this big race and you know where else to be, so you must have been mistaken. This is my friend Jess, and she was at the door, and then her husband heard the commotion and came up like he's got their baby in their hand. And so he was joining the conversation, and he tried to reason with the man at the door again, explaining that they were in town to run a race, you know, were exhausted, taking care of child, like, this is my child, like, you must be mistaken, you must have the wrong house. And said that the man wasn't listening, that he continued to raise his voice and to call them liars, and anyways, so that was pretty despicable is not the right word, but surprising, because we had never had any really bad encounters since we moved in, so I thought, like, this is pretty weird, like, I couldn't believe it was. Okay, anyways, I went outside to investigate after that. I did find two cans, and I think it must have been like high school kids because we live right beside a park. So maybe it was Saturday night and high school kids would come by, whatever. It was like a Mike's Hard Lemonade beer can or something. I cleaned them up. Anyways, so that was that. He also notes that there's parking proposal. I noticed the parking proposal for the applicant shows parking available inside the garage. From what I have observed, the garage is jammed full of recreational gear, such as numerous mountain bikes, ski gear, etc. It has never been parked in. There is no room. This is not true. We park in it all the time. I parked in it last weekend. We do have lots of recreational gear. That's why we're here. Not a crime. We can also move that. We have a shed. So if we were to have renters, very easy to make more room if we needed to. Lastly, to my knowledge, this particular neighbor not only has a suite in their house that they rent out, but they also used to vacation rent that space without the proper zoning. They have an active website and Airbnb listing that suggests they offer, and I quote, short-term accommodation for people wanting to enjoy Revelstoke and area in a home-like atmosphere. That's exactly what we would like to.
Jackie, I want you to focus on your property.
Okay.
And tell council why they should be approving it.
Okay.
And
okay.
We are coming up to about 25 minutes, and because you're the proponent, I've allowed it to happen, but it's 5 minutes.
Okay, I apologize.
Okay.
I will get back.
That's all right. I just want to, we still have a lot to do still.
Yeah, you bet. Okay. Obviously, I put a lot of time into this. We love our neighborhood. We want to preserve a sense of community and a family-filled residence, and we think we can do both. We can have a quiet vacation rental. We bought this neighborhood for all the same reasons. We've had great experiences with Friendship in the past. And we think we can bring, like, we think we're capable of bringing other interesting people into the neighborhood. We're asking for chance to the infrequent renters, rentals. I guess, yeah, so when you're deciding whether or not to approve, people, you think about some of the things that you're, some of the things you're considering is, do you think these owners are, or have earnest intentions? Are they honest? Are they going to honor their word? Are they good neighbors, right? I think, I hope that it's obvious that we're good neighbors, even if some people are concerned about what if in the future, like currently we are good owners. I understand a lot of people are thinking not in my backyard, but I'm hoping you guys can look beyond that, give way to how hard we're trying, and maybe recognize that we'll have vacation rentals, the ones that you need to approve, this would be a great one. Like we're the good guys. You have the people who tried really hard and have gone above and beyond to make sure that we can create that really welcoming space in this awesome city. So hope that you agree.
Thank you. Next person on the list is Becky Peck.
I got my notes on my phone.
Hello, I'm Becky Peck, and I live at 1060 McCarty Crescent, right across the street from Jackie and Ben. I don't know if you can see it. So we just built, you may know me from a couple weeks ago, I was here speaking for our application. Just to start off, I wanted to say a few words about Ben and Jackie. We've had the pleasure of getting to know them since they moved in last year, and they're great people. They are truly a lovely couple in every way, and we feel very fortunate to have them right across the street. They've been nothing but good neighbors to us. They're very solid, and as you can see, she's on it and very organized. We ourselves are new to town, as we moved here about a year and a half ago, and in our opinion, from what we know of Jackie and Ben, they embody the spirit of Revelstoke. They're genuine, energetic, they're youthful, outdoorsy kind, and they're excited to be here. We built our house across the street over the last year, and Ben has always been quick to lend a hand when we have needed him, and they're both great with our kids. Jackie pops over to babysit and play when needed, and has endless fun energy for our three-year-old, who likes to demand that of her. After reading some of the letters of opposition, I'm kind of left with the feeling of sadness and disappointment about what's going on in our neighborhood. Because some very big assumptions have been made about our friends and neighbors, Ben and Jackie, and many of them are false and, quite frankly, unkind words have been spoken. And I find it saddening, and so does my husband, Corey. And from what we understand, very few neighbors have actually attempted to get to know them how we know them and to communicate it to them face to face. And this is hard, because it's too bad, because they're great. And so many points, Jackie touched on them, I won't go into them, being brought up that are not only false assumptions but irrelevant to the application. I won't go into them. So for us, we're right across the street, and parking has never been an issue for us with them. And if anyone should have issue, it's us, because we're directly where the parking they do park. And they're always respectful. They stay completely off the street. They have roommates, so obviously there's a couple of cars, because they explain the roommate situation right now. And everyone's been great. For our own selfish reasons. We support this obviously for multiple reasons, but one of the main reasons we support it selfishly is we have two small children, and the less traffic idea sounds great to us, so we would rather have less traffic. So having, is it 30 days a year of vacation rental would be nicer for us, and we would know when it's happening, communicate, and less traffic for our kids to play than roommates year round. Yeah, so the fact they have a couple cars in their driveway shows that they have friends and family that can visit them, and that's, I think, a normal thing for people around the store. Over the last few months, we've also had the pleasure of meeting Ben and Jackie's relatives, their brothers, their parents, and their friends. And Ben and Jackie don't have kids, but it's clear that they share the same family values as the rest of the neighborhood, as we've met all their family, and they're all great, normal, wonderful people. So I'm here to obviously voice our support, I think, for my husband Corey Peck as well on the application. Jackie is, she just very meticulously stated all of the concrete details of how they would run their vacation rental professionally and respectfully, so I don't need to repeat those. but I really believe her and I trust her that they'll do exactly that. There's no doubt in our minds that they'll do a great job if given the chance, and no doubt they'd be compliant with the rules and neighborhood courtesies that go along with running a vacation rental professionally. I'll try not to repeat anything, but the same concerns again and again come up about the concern about the enforcement if things don't go how they say it will go. So I don't know what to say. I just feel it's a bit unfair that there's not a system that allows them to be accountable, to give them a chance. So you guys have already talked over this again, so I won't go into that. But if there was some kind of system, then maybe the neighbors could get on board and trust, give them a chance to trust, and give them a chance. I feel that if this application is stopped because of a whole bunch of what-ifs, it's really a shame, because they're great people and I think they'll do a great job. And I urge you, sorry, I don't want to repeat that, what I said. I just hope they can be given a chance. They're great people we trust, and let them follow their dreams and host tourists from all over the world for only 30 days a year. And if it doesn't go well, can their business license be taken away? Just give them a shot, and after all this, I'm sure they'll follow the rules. They're very aware of all the rules. So we support it, and that's all. They're great. Okay, thank you.
There's one other name on the list here, but I'm not, I think that she might have put her name on the wrong one. It's Nancy Jensen.
That's right.
The floor is open. State your name and address, sir.
My name is Darcy. You know what this is?
No.
Sure. I come to Revelstoke with good intentions, provide a vacation rental. Neither of those applications get declined. I'll have no choice but to sell my property and move forward. I can't pretend to understand your hidden agendas. Why you name a town after Lord Revelstoke, who in 1890 had to step away because of corruption? I think the corruption's still in this town, and I'm going to get to the bottom of it. I'm in favor of both, and if they either get declined, you leave me no choice but to sell my home. And furthermore, I was late today because I couldn't find any parking downtown. Parking's an issue. So I wasn't here for the first one to be in favor. My property right now is cleared. I do not have access to 4th Street. If you can expedite that so I can have access to 4th Street so I can give it to my neighbor whose property you approved, which is encroaching city land, because if you look at the application, it encroaches city land, it encroaches my land, but you still fast forwarded it because it's downtown. When her people are coming up, they're coming up with a truck and a trailer. Her property cannot accommodate the people that were there last week. She can park on my land. I'm a neighbor, I'm here for a neighborhood. But I'm starting to learn the neighbors here aren't looking out for each other. Thank you.
Thank you. Floor is open for 1065 McCarty Crescent. Deborah, and then Kathy, and
I'm Deborah Nero. I live in 1101 Keshava Crescent. I live next door to the not operating vacation rental in our neighborhood. The property still is zoned as vacation rental, and it can be run as a vacation rental again. The neighbor that owns that property, very nice person. It's not about good people, bad people. Very nice person, very diligent about who she rented to. Didn't change the fact that she rented to 6 guys one weekend. There ended up being 30 guys there for a stay. That they party all night. When the owner is not on the property, it can't be managed properly. And it doesn't affect just the people across the street. It affects the whole neighborhood. And we've been in that neighborhood. Some of the people have been there for 50 years. So even though it's relatively new in some parts, it's a well-established neighborhood that I chose to retire.
Thank you.
Kathy East, 1089 McCarty. So last time I came, I felt I was really kind of strident and pounding my fist. It was the first time I attended one of these hearings. And So now I've heard from a number of neighborhoods, and I hear the same concerns that I have. I don't want this to be about the people. It's not about the people, it's about the use of the property. And I want to echo Lorna and Deb's concerns for this particular property. It's where it is, it's the number of kids that are around, and it's just not the right fit for this neighborhood. The fact that there are four bedrooms, you know, that's eight guests, if they're all being compliant, that's minimum of two cars, you know, and regardless of how we try to manage these properties, and yes, Brian and I do have, currently we have long-term tenants, and we do have a suite in our home, and I've never been opposed to that. There are lots of suites in our neighborhood, and people are renting them for various purposes, and we're looking at going through the process ourselves. And we would like to see ourselves as bed and breakfast, and that's another conversation. Hearing about 305 4th Street, that's what we don't want this neighborhood to become. There are a lot of vacant lots in our neighborhood, and I guess we're coming to hearings every time a new house is built and somebody tries to designate it or have it rezoned vacation rental. I think you're hearing that there's no appetite for that in established neighborhoods. I feel for these people. I hear their intent to make a go of it and to do a good job at it. And I think they're probably good candidates to offer, perhaps, I don't know if they have a suite in their home, but long-term rental through their suite or maybe bed and breakfast. As far as marketing through Airbnb, I agree. I really think Airbnb is a good platform. And I think that you are able to screen your clientele, but you have to be really diligent. You have to say, we don't allow trucks in our driveway. We have no room for trailers in our driveway. Sorry, we don't allow sleds. We cater to families, as the homeowner said. But you really do have to work with that. And I believe that both of these young people are working. And I can tell you as a retired person, this is my second job. And I devote all of my time to it. And when we have people on site, and we're always there. Now, with one exception, I'll admit, one weekend we went away and we asked a neighbor, which is the Airbnb policy, you make sure you've got a neighbor who's keeping the lookout for you. And honestly, I wouldn't do that again either. Okay, and yes, it really is important to screen your renters, and you can do that through Airbnb, but it is a lot of work. So my main concerns are, as in the last time, it's the number of kids and the proximity to the entrance to the park and the mailbox, and the fact that the homeowner is not on site, and therefore you really are not able to monitor what's going on in your property. And to say that, yeah, we're going to we'll have fines and so on, that's all good for the homeowner, but the damage is already done, the noise is already, you know, the neighborhood's already disrupted, and fine, the family, the homeowners might get compensated for damage to their home, but it doesn't address the fact that the neighborhood's been turned upside down. So eight people, that's a lot of people. I'd say that's too many for that corner, and I'm concerned about the number of cars. We also have had letters published publicly about our property, and it's hurtful, and I'm saddened that it has come to this. We don't want to be those kinds of neighbors, and we don't want to have to come to these hearings all the time, but we will, so that we can maintain the character of the neighborhood. And we are new to the neighborhood. We're not the 27-year residents. We're not the 50-year residents, but we're there because we recognize the quality of the neighborhood. We don't want to become 4th Street. So we're definitely opposed to this. And honestly, again, referring to the property, not the people, I don't know them, and I'm sure I could take Becky's word that they're great people, but based on the number of cars that we've seen on site there, it's hard to say, yeah, we'll give you a chance when this is going to go on the title, and it's going to carry forward to anybody else who takes ownership of that property. we all have dinner parties, we all have people over, and we're all trying to be cognizant of the fact that we can't have cars on the street. That's different. That's not turning your home over to somebody, your home over to somebody who does not have an investment in the neighborhood. So I believe that's it. I really would like to get these, you know, our neighborhood on solid footing in terms of neighborly relations. It's very upsetting to feel that these young people are not feeling welcome in the neighborhood. And I want to reiterate, it's not about the homeowner, it's about the use of the property that we're opposed to. So unless the homeowner's on site, we're adamantly against this.
Thank you. Lauren.
Thank you. I just wanted to come back briefly because Jackie did address some of the points that I raised. So I just wanted to make sure that my position or my thoughts on those comments are just before you. Again, as other people, this is not about the nature of the individuals and whether or not they will run a good business and whether or not they're honest or whether or not. It's not about people. As we know, people change. Life changes.
Probably.
The zoning goes with the property.
No, I mean, they're just
going to
schedule them.
Sorry?
Oh, no.
Oh, sorry.
Okay.
So, yeah, I mean, this is, you know, we can get used to saying what if. Well, we have to say what if. I plan to live in my house for a very long time. I'm not going anywhere.
They're just going
to I'll just wait.
This Dawn, she's asking a question about procedure. Why don't you go and figure out what's going on? Sorry, Lauren, carry on.
Okay. So anyway, yes, what if is a really huge question for us and our son.
Mr. Howitt, we don't need that kind of behavior here. If you can carry on like that, you can leave.
Sorry, I just fell asleep. Sorry, it's been a tiring day.
I just warned you.
Okay, we'll pull this together.
I'll do my best to be more lively. Entertaining.
Do you understand?
So, yes, we do have to.
Sorry.
Okay. I'll just rewind. I'll try to make the same point one more time with vigor and in an entertaining fashion. I am very concerned about what if, because I plan to live in my house for a very long time. And I know that our son and daughter-in-law plan to be there for at least as long as the kids are going to be, you know, which is a very long time. So what if is huge. And that house with four bedrooms and up to who knows how many trucks with trailers and sleds in the driveway, on the corner, gutting it is not appropriate. I echo some of the concerns for other, we've been heard, when the owner is not on the property, it falls to neighbors to enforce. And that is just a constant source of potential knots in the stomach. You hear the noise. You do something. You lie there. I'm in my, I'm just listening to the noise coming. Do you do something? Yeah. Do you? Non-appropriate place for that kind of a situation. This is a single family neighborhood with small kids. It's not where you put that. You know, it's okay. You know, we're much more comfortable with the suites in the basement where the owner's on site. They just did that. Go ahead. Yeah, that's containable. This is not containable. I just want to say, lovely people. This is the first time I've seen it, but, you know, no doubt. Nothing to do with it. Not in the slightest. At all. It's about our neighborhood, what we built, and what we plan to keep on building and maintaining for the future, and the kind of neighbors that we hope to attract on the few vacant lots that are left on McCarty Crescent.
Thank you.
My name is Brian Tobin, and I'm Kathy's husband, and I live at 1089 McCarty Crescent. So I'm kind of gobsmacked at this whole process. because it's gotten out of control. And there are things being said that he said, she said, and it's not right. I'm not going to address, I was the person that was addressed in that letter, and I didn't address those issues specifically, but I think it needs to be known that regardless of the screening you do for a vacation rental, you are not guaranteed the type of guest you want. And for certain, you're not there when things go bad. And usually they go bad at 1 or 3 in the morning, as they have already. And it's concerning to me that in the last public hearing here, a statement was made, and I'm not calling any blame, but the statement was made by the city that there was no record of any complaints of a vacation rental that had been approved. And we know in our neighborhood that that's simply not true, that there were multiple complaints. With respect...
I just want to clarify that, Brian. You're saying that multiple complaints about...
The licensed vacation rental, the one on Cushadel Crescent. Okay. So I don't know how you log those complaints, but I know that the RCMP were called. So maybe the RCMP doesn't tell the city bylaw services that there was a complaint. And I'm pretty sure, perhaps, that that bylaw services don't tell the RCMP. But we have seen instances where people are ripping through the neighborhood. And Mark, you know what, you're there. Everyone that lives on that street knows that there's a kid that can bounce around the crescent on a pogo stick, dribbling a basketball. And so that they need to slow down when they're in our community. And I would respectfully say that the person that's just moved into the house, that's here having a good time, whether they're from Ontario or Washington State or wherever, don't know that. So within this applicant's house, there are 9 kids within 3 doors. And there's a bunch more within the rest of the block. And what we're asking is that we did some research. We moved into an R1 neighborhood. We knew that there were people that had suites. Right beside our lot, there is a bed and breakfast. And I've expressed my frustration with the city. Kathy and I are not running, well, I guess it's semantics. Someone could say we're illegal. We knew what we wanted. Kathy went to the planning desk and told them what we wanted, and she purchased a license and brought it back. Not only did we purchase a license, but we are members of the Chamber of Commerce. And we're both involved in the community other than our little suite. So we're not trying, I noticed that the license wasn't proper. I'd been talking to a neighbor and I had to go back and look at it and go, crap, that's not the right license. So I immediately went back down to the planning desk and I told them that they had sold us the wrong license. Now I'm not blaming them. Somewhere the communication broke down. But when you look at, so what we really wanted was a B&B license. And when you look at a B&B license, I had Alex Cooper email me a front page from an article, two different articles from January and February of 2014. And at that time, you were striking a new bylaw for governing B&Bs. And at that time, Of the 23 that were licensed, 22 were non-conforming. And Dean Strachan, the planner at the time, is on record as saying, our new B&B bylaw will bring all of those people into compliance. My wife and I, before we moved here 2 years ago, have been coming here for close to 9 years, let's say. And we've stayed in a lot of those places. And so we modeled our place after one of those places. And it offers things that you can't get in a motel room. You can't, a 220 volt clothes dryer that I'm not allowed to have in a B&B license, but somehow it's safer to push a chair up against a wall or a baseboard heater. So I know I'm getting off track, but that's part of the frustration here. And for the PECs, if all they could have done was laid down $50 and got a B&B license, they wouldn't have even been a part of this process. But I'm arguing that people come in and they see something for a way that they say isn't to make money, but it kind of is. Like, it, you know, it kind of is. You know, someone new moves in, and I think we've been pretty good with our neighbors, with Jackie and Ben. I don't know how quickly they got into it, but there's a housewarming party, and we've got over 100 people at the house. And you know, stuff is going on, and a neighbor knocks on the door and asks them to shut it down at 11 o'clock, and then at 1 o'clock, and then at 3 o'clock. How do they expect the open arms, like, you know, they kind of set the tone themselves, and, you know, I get the PECs wanting to support it. I mean, that's, but it changes our neighborhood, and there's a lot of empty lots in our neighborhood, and we don't, had we wanted to live beside the Swiss Chalet or some kind of motel village, we might have considered property down on First Street, where you approved one in the last council, where no one objected, and the proponent didn't even show up to promote it. So I suspect there are areas in the city where it's more welcomed. But in the meetings that I've attended, whether they be Birch, or whether they be Hay Road, or whether they be downtown or airport, in every instance where there is a semblance, Aspen, there's been, people don't want that. They want responsible people in those houses, and they want responsible people that will look out for their kids. And everyone on McCarty Crescent knows, and Cushato and Pine Ridge and Newlands, they all know where those kids are, and they all slow down. If you're from out of town, you don't. And we know that for a fact. In some cases, they think it's okay to tow snowboarders around on pickup trucks and snowmobiles. And that's, it's not party central, it's not motel village. It's an R1 neighborhood that allows basement suites.
Thank you. Floor is open for comments for 1065 McCarty Crescent.
I will make it really brief. I know everybody's tired. I hear their comments. I get it. The what ifs, and I understand. And you know what? Totally valid points, especially the one like, you know, you can do all the screening in the world, but how do you know who's going to rent your house? That's a good point. How do you know when you get in your car you're not going to get into an accident? Well, you don't, but you drive slow, your seatbelt, you take all of the precautions that you possibly can, and then hope you get there and go on about your day. You don't just stay home. So it's kind of similar. Like, there's always risks, but wouldn't you rather let it be with somebody who's taken all the time and effort, or would you rather it be some person who is not vested in the property, who's not going to do the check-ins, who didn't go to the time to do a brochure, who doesn't, you know what I mean? There's so many reasons to at least give us a chance, and like I said before, it's not as if it's over if this application were to go forward. At that point, there still is the issue of licensing, so there's still a say if things go awry. Okay, that's all. Thank you very much for all of your time and attention.
Any more comments from the public for a second time?
Terry Marshall, 1031 Nickel. We've lived on our property for 38 years. We're not planning on going anywhere. We love our neighborhood. But it's becoming stressful living in the neighborhood because we have to keep fighting for our quiet enjoyment of the neighborhood. I just want to make a comment. I've already written our letter of protest to 1065 McCarty. We've lived there before. There was a McCarty Crescent or a shadow bench. But I wanted to just clarify the parking situation. There's between 5 and 9 vehicles parked in that driveway every weekend. There have been vehicles parked on the street overnight. And on the weekend, there was, I think there was 5 on this past weekend. We walk by there 4 times a day, walking our dog through the park. And there was actually a vehicle in the driveway with a camper on it, and someone was camping in the driveway as well. So just to clarify that situation, and thanks for your time.
Floor is open for comments on 1065 McCarty Crescent.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon, Your Worship and Council. Kurt Kravinsky, 1065 McCarty Crescent. 3.5 years ago, I was honored to be selected to work in Revelstoke. My family and I purchased our home in a wonderful neighborhood on a quiet street. We did not choose to live in a commercial environment. We bought in a residential location. I respectfully request that you consider the impact that old home vacation rentals have on residents in this neighborhood. Thank you.
Any comments for a second time? Any comments from the public a third time on 1065 McCarty Crescent? Looking for a motion to close the public hearing. Councillor Nixon, seconded by Councillor Soles. All those in favor, motion's carried.
Your Worship, I'll bring forward for discussion purposes that zoning amendment bylaw 2167 be read a third time.
Motion by Councillor Nixon, seconded by Councillor Soles. Councillor Nixon.
Your Worship, I won't be supporting this. Council had the experience of having a whole home vacation rental down in that area before and thought it would be well managed. And this is not about the people that own the home. This is about zoning the land. Definitely we're finding that the established neighborhoods are just not going to tolerate these whole home vacation homes, not even if they're managed as best they can. And the one word I worry about going forward is the balance between us being able to manage from city bylaws with our commissioners or calling out the RCMP, but also balancing it with vigilantism. And I worry about putting that sort of situation into a pocket neighborhood. So I won't be voting in favor.
Any other comments from council? Councillor Soles.
Your Worship, I won't support this going forward. Had we not had the experience of prior application, and I voted for that one other time, and then the wheels went off the train, I might be more apt to look at this. But when we don't see the property owner on the property and in due diligence is being what it is, you can look at it and say we're going to have the best intentions of having the best renters, and all it takes is somebody to come along who's not even renting. And then it mars these people who are having the best intentions. It's unfortunate. It seems to be working as a rental accommodation for them with roommates, and if that's what it takes for them to support it, then that's what they'll probably have to do. So I won't support this motion.
Any other comments on this motion? All those in favor? Against? Motion is denied. And we're going to take a two-minute break before we go into 11:15 Montana Place.